So what was less than satisfactory to him was the fact that they didn't have applied music at Chicago University. To this day, they don't have applied music. You can only study theory and musicology, you know. So he said, if I could come up and create at the music department to my own ideals, and while I was there, he was being talked to by the administration, came down to see him. The president himself came to see him, President Dijkstra at that time. I was there, and he said to me one evening, you know, they have been asking me if I would be interested in the job up in Wisconsin. Would you be interested in joining a university? Yes, I said.
And who is this asking?
This is Carl Bricken, the man who was the head of the music department in Chicago, see?
Was he a musicologist?
No, he was a composer and pianist, student of Cortot. But he deserves immense credit for having created the artist in residence for residency for musicians. They had already one painter here. So it was kind of a normal thing that they should... And they had John Stuart Curry. You know, John Stuart Curry was here. Grant Wood was in Iowa. Thomas Benton was in Kansas. They were called the three regionalists. And that happened in the mid-30s. As a matter of fact, Stuart Curry came in 37 and had been here 2 years when they brought me as the first musician in as artist in residence. And I said yes to this because I knew the plan was to bring the Poate Quartet the following year. So there were five artists in residence all of a sudden, counting the painter, six of us. And that...
Did that include teaching then?
Limited teaching because the administration was wise enough to see if they wanted us to maintain ourselves as instrumentalists par excellence, that it takes a lot of work. And, of course, preparations for the innumerable concerts that we gave. It was not just done by the scores, but it was by the many dozens of concerts that we gave over the year. And we played a lot representing the University of Wisconsin. For instance, in 1941, we played all the Brahms music, first at USC, chamber music, eight concerts of all Brahms music. Of course, I was a pianist for it.
With Proadem.
With the Proadem. And we played it at Berkeley, that means at Cal, and we played it at Stanford. And we played all the chamber music of Beethoven that same year in the fall in USC, the University of Southern California. And we played all of this at the Library of Congress. All of this happened in 1941. That was the densest year of concerts for us. So you see that this would already make 50 concerts right there, let alone what we did here, and the Poate played all over the state, as they do to this year, to this day, you know. They're playing a lot in the state. And in New York, and now they have a manager, and they play all over the lot.
Different personnel.
Different personnel.
Almost entirely.
Yeah, as a matter of fact, the primarius of the Poate Quartet never got to play a single note. Leukemia took him before they took the job here. In 1940. He died in the fall of 1940. So the personnel is entirely different than it was then. But they play at least as well as they ever did at this point. They, of course, they had glorious years with Rudolf Kolisch. Rudolf Kolisch joined them as primarius in 1944. And of course it was a great privilege for me to have a colleague like Rudolf Kolisch. He was a great, great force here and a marvelous friend, and we played uncounted recitals together.
Were you ever going back to Europe at all?
Yes, I went back to Europe in 1931 the first time.
Concertizing?
Concertizing, Played in all the main cities in London, in Paris, in Berlin, Copenhagen, of course, Amsterdam, The Hague. It was a big tour. And I met with Mrs. Busoni for the first time. You know that I come from the Busoni school, huh? Yeah, I'm a student of Egon Petri.
Yes,
you know that.
I was going to bring that up,
And I became his student. I came to New York, to Berlin, when I was 14 years of age, which was very courageous of my parents for sending me, and wonderful of my teacher, who was Victor Schöler. the great pianist in Denmark at that time, and a man of extraordinary intellect. Besides,
was he the teacher of Victor Borge also?
Yeah, he was.
Borge Rosenbaum, I think.
Borge Rosenbaum, yes. Yeah, he was the teacher of Borge. And there was a, the double reason for him changing his name to Victor was the victory sign, you know, from World War II.
Oh.
That was initiated by Churchill.
Yeah.
And also because of him having studied with Victor Schuller. I'm not dead sure about that, but yeah. It seems to me I have heard that. So this was, of course, Victor Schuller in 1919 began his career as a pianist. He was then probably 20 years old. I had studied with him for one year. I studied with him from 18 on.
So he wasn't terrible.
And I came to him by way of Ignaz Friedman, for whom I had played in the summertime. And in the fall, on his advice, I became a student of his most gifted student, Victor Schuller, who was then probably 18, maybe 19. Friedman had lived in the World War 1 year, more or less as a refugee in Copenhagen. And
his was a Polish citizenship?
Yeah.
Probably.
So this is how I came to Victor Schuller. Mm-hmm. And he was absolutely marvelous to me. And when I had studied with him for 2 years, he had me ready to play with orchestra the E-flat Liszt concerto. So I made my debut with the orchestra. And right after that, he took me along to Germany to attend some of his concerts and introduce me to some friends he had in Berlin, where he had the idea that I should go and study with Busoni, which was mighty generous, wonderful of him, because I could yet have learned a lot from him. But he felt that it would be great if I could be with an influence like Busoni. So I went to Berlin and was introduced to this wonderful family, which consisted of an older mother and 35-ish daughter. And they took me in just like their child. And I lived with them for the 4 years I studied in Berlin, mm-hmm. just like a child of the family. Meantime, the lady married, and I lived partially with them, partially with the mother.
Yeah.
And I was one and a half, really only one block away, one house removed from where Claudio Arrault lived.
Did you know him?
No, we never. But I knew him as a name, you know. I heard him play when he was 14 years. I heard him play in Copenhagen. I think he's a few years older than I am, maybe one or two years.
He's
born in 4?
He's 80, yeah.
Yeah, he's born in 4.
I think this year he's
80. 80.
Yeah,
you see, I was born in 6. So he was 2 years older than I was. So he came when I was 12 years old to Denmark and played a concert I never forgot. It was brilliant.
Yeah.
He was 14 years old. In Berlin, I remember also seeing the advertisement of he's doing the whole Wildtemperl Klavier in 3 concerts,
yeah.
All 48. Incredible. That was astounding. He was a student of a man who had been a student of Liszt, Martin Krause. And the lady lady in the house where I lived had been a student of Martin Krause.
Mm-hmm.
Well, they lived just across the street, see?
Yeah. So Berlin must have been terribly exciting at this time.
Oh, it was exciting like no other place on earth had been, because they did not only have their indigenous musicians like the 3 operas that were going full tilt all year around, the Charlottenburger Opera, the Staats Opera, and the Opera am Alexanderplatz. There were 3 of them going full tilt. And they had the Philharmonic and they had the Blüthner Orchestra. So there were 2 orchestras playing schedules all the time. But to that you added all the refugees from Russia that had fled from the revolution in 17.
Oh, yeah. Uh-huh.
Yeah. One who fled Russia was the famous pianist Rachmaninoff, no less. He came and settled in Copenhagen. He lived in Copenhagen for a year or a year and a half. And he happened to live underneath the apartment where friends of my mother lived above. And they didn't know who he was. But then they got wise to the fact that he was the composer of the famous C-sharp prelude. And one day when they met him on the steps on this apartment house, they said to him, "Mr. Rachmaninoff, we understand you must be having students." "No," they said, "because they heard very slow practicing, see, five-finger exercises."
Yeah.
He said, "That's me practicing." You see, he hadn't played the piano for quite a long time. Mm-hmm. He had been composing and conducting, and he started out from scratch. But when he came to Copenhagen, he was scheduled to play concerts. And I remember very well seeing Rachmaninoff's concerts announced, but it was cancelled because we had that deadly influenza and all public gatherings were scheduled. So he never played that concert.
About 1919?
1918 it was, 18, yeah. in the fall, late fall, November. It was cancelled. But Friedman, who was there, had said of him, "Here is a man whose shoelaces I am not worthy of tying." That was generous of Friedman to say this, because he was one of the superb pianists, musicians, and also a very, very fine composer.
Oh.
I'm enraptured by them. So I said to myself, I heard him when I was 11 years old, see, 1917. It had colossal elan, his playing, that is, and rhythmic vitality like no one. So it was not just rosy memories I had of his youngster, 11 years old, easily swept off his feet. But when I listened back to it, he was incomparable in certain respects. No one played with the sweep that he did. No, he I just played for him.
So
he said, "Well, I'm leaving Denmark now." It was towards the end of World War I. And you must go and study with my student, Victor Schöler. This is how it went. And Schöler then took me to Berlin, as I was telling you, and I wrote letters, and so did this lady with whom I lived, wrote letters to Busoni, who lived some, maybe 10 blocks away, in a very famous penthouse on top of a building on a square, round square, I should say, called Victoria Luisenplatz, and we never got a letter. We never got an answer for him. So I began to tell you that in 31, when I finally met Mrs. Busoni, I said to Mrs. Busoni, "You know, when I first came, my hope was to study with your husband." And she said, when she heard the letters that I had written to her and no answer, he said, "Ferruccio," she said, "was so jealous of his time that everything that didn't pertain to his daily bread and had to be answered for that reason, slid right in the waste paper basket." He evidently sensed that his years were not many because he died in 24, you know.
24,
yeah. And besides that, he had no interest in piano playing, really. That has been, and had been true for years, because he lived, if you read his letters, he lived for years for composing and managed to compose in the summer month as he traveled during the fall and the winter, chiefly in America, to scrape money together so he could nourish his family and buy some free time for composing.
But so he had a real coterie of...
That he did, yeah, I mean. As I have said, they didn't speak about Busoni, they spoke in German about der Busoni, the Busoni.
Yeah,
der Busoni.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you didn't meet him? Or?
Yes, I did get to meet him six weeks before he died.
Mm-hmm.
I had first performed the new version of his Chopin variations in 23, and Mrs. Busoni was there to hear that. On the basis of that, he had heard about me also from Petri. He had heard this very amusing thing. Petri said to him, "You know, I have a young student who's very gifted." I said to him, "Bring me something else than Bach or Busoni. I want to hear some Chopin from you." I said, "Everybody plays Chopin. I'm not interested in playing that." I had played my share of Chopin. I certainly knew all the etudes. And he said, "Oh, yeah, I want you to play something else." So I began to play Liszt, which I was also terribly fond of. So I brought him my first lesson. I brought the six first Liszt etudes. And next lesson, I mean to say. And then I brought the other six. So I played, in two lessons, I played the Liszt etudes. And that was amazing. We could cover that much. But he was not a man of many words. He would sit down and demonstrate for you course it meant more than 1,000 words. In the meantime, I had been with Friedrich Lamont and quite frequently played for Edwin Fischer, who guided me really. He said, if you can go and study with Busoni, you must study with Egon Petri, who now was a teacher at the Hochschule in Berlin. See?
Yeah.
So I got an introduction from Fischer to the director of the Hochschule, who was Franz Schrecker. And he introduced me then to Petri.
So you were with Petri
two years.
Yeah.
How did they were tremendously meaningful years.
How did he conceive of teaching?
Not like Lamont, with whom I had been with, who was, I would say, the poorest teacher I had.
Yeah.
Because he would intercept you every 2-3 measures. He said, not like that, and then he would go on, and not like that, and, but like this. But he would play for you. But
and he was a pupil of Liszt himself, wasn't he, Lamont?
Well, this is what you read, but what I recall was that he said he was a pupil of Bülow. That's what my own ears heard him say. But he might very well have attended the classes without having played for Liszt, you know. But you can read that he was a pupil of Liszt.
Yeah.
But he was in Copenhagen in 1927, and I remember I was with him in his hotel room, and he told me that he was a pupil of von Bülow. But I could also be wrong.
Yeah.
But this is what I recall.
Yeah. So Petri let you have the more room to...
Oh, yeah, of course, Petri let you play the work through, and then he would make his comments. But with Lamont, it was always this, you never played a whole sentence, you know. How could you make anything out of that? He was really a poor teacher. Mm-hmm. But I learned from him. I certainly did learn something from observing him. And when it was his 60th birthday, I brought him a bouquet of roses. And his wife, who was a famous actress, Irene Trich, opened the door for the next lesson when I came after his birthday. He said, did you remember, she said to her husband, to thank Mr. Johansen, I was 15 years old now, Mr. Johansen, for the flowers? To which he answered gruffly, I am no lady. Yeah, don't bring me flowers. He was gruff like you could imagine Beethoven would have been in his off moments, you know? And he looked like Beethoven. He truly looked like Beethoven.
Yeah, I've heard that. Yeah, I've
he truly thing. Did.
Yeah.
And Beethoven, of course, was his specialty as a performer. Mm-hmm. But he also played Liszt very well.
But Petri was your main...
That was my main imprint. Between Schoeller and Petri, which kind of reflects Friedman.
Mm-hmm. How would could you... Could you characterize Petri as a...
He would not shy away from talking about technique. He would not, but to me, he never did. But I often sat in on other students' lessons. See, I would have my lesson maybe at 8 o'clock in the morning, and then somebody come at 9, some at 10, and he got there. You know how he got there? He bicycled quite a long distance. Long distance he bicycled in the morning, so he must have had to leave the house at 7 o'clock, because it's just... teaching certainly began at 8 o'clock.
And he lived a long time, I think.
He was 80, yeah. In his 80s, early 80s when he died. As a matter of fact, he died in 62, and he was born in 82, so he was just 80. Mm-hmm. He was born in 82, like Schnabel. Yes, he was an outstanding teacher, and I'll tell you what the greatest transmission was, the fact that he played for you, and you could observe mm-hmm. how he held his hands, and his hands were the most ideal you could imagine.
In what way?
The most ideal in the way that each finger seemed to have its own musculature. They were certainly more individually and uniformly shaped. He had been a violinist in his early years. He didn't really major in the piano until he was 18. But he had studied with Carreño when he was a youngster. So he was bilingual, you might say. Yeah. He played the violin and the piano. But he didn't concentrate on it. Mm-hmm. I think he sat in the Dresden Opera Orchestra in his early, maybe he was 16, 17. But when he was 18, he devoted himself wholly to the piano. And of course, he was the great student of Busoni. There's no question about that, already from early on. He talked about hand position and what was characteristic of the Busoni school was something referred to as prefixation. It means that the form that your hand had to be in order to strike a chord was already set milliseconds before.
Consciously.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And of course you know that the characteristic thing of piano playing at that time or a decade before had changed from the Breithaupt, mm-hmm. or rather from the Lischitzky straitjacket way of holding your hand with the knuckles buried, as it were. And now Breithaupt, with the natural piano technique, came around. Say, oh no, it's not by finger articulation that you play the piano. You must liberate the hand and have it loose, and you shake your way to it. Mm-hmm. Well, you know, Schnabel had been a student of Lischitzky. Mm-hmm. And he completely turned that around when the Breithaupt method came along. And he played the piano more along the Breithauptian lines than anybody. And when he plays what you call broken octaves, body, 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 mm-hmm. you can hear that they're not even, because they say bite, 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 instead of body, bite, bop, 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 bop.
Yeah.
And you can hear it. Right. And his trills were also apt to be bite, 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 instead of bite, 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 bite. Mm-hmm. Petri's.
You hear one note more than the other.
Yes, yes, kind of. Petri's description of a trill is a repetition of two neighboring notes so rapid that you can't recognize the one from the other. Which I love, which is not true, because what Busoni did was to rhythmicize the trill, so you play so many notes
yeah.
per 16th or 8th notes, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
He wrote
them out
yeah.
in certain rhythm, which I think is absolutely, of course, if it's in triplets, you avoid the leaning on one, bye, 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 because pa 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 pa, you know, it becomes
yes.
a matter of distributing it on the two tones
yeah.
rather than one prevailing.
Uh-huh.
So such things Petri, of course, would talk about. And the characteristic thing, of course, was the little finger compensating for in shortness and being rather straight down where the fingers are curved. Not long ago, I heard that Rachmaninoff and Hoffmann were talking together about technical difficulties and the way to practice and overcome the inequality that nature has dictated to the fingers, as it were. And Hoffmann said to Rachmaninoff, "You watch and see. It's not the fourth finger, but it's the." It's the third finger that's the weak member,
mm-hmm.
which Rachmaninoff went home to observe. He said, "I found that it was not only the third finger, but it was also the second finger, the first, and the fifth." Something to that effect. Yeah. Well, you know what Chopin had to say about that while we're on that subject. He had a very interesting and surrealistic way of expressing his own personage towards the end of his life.
Mm-hmm.
He said, "All that's left of me is an overgrown nose and an underdeveloped fourth finger."
Yeah.
Have you ever heard that?
No.
No, but this is an unbelievably amusing description. As he lost more and more weight, you know,
uh-huh.
yeah, he became kind of a caricature of himself. But the underdeveloped fourth finger.
Were you in Berlin at this time? There must have been theater and the visual arts and about dance and so forth. You
tremendous,
were just,
tremendous.
You must have been just immersed. In all
yeah, that. Yeah. Of course, one couldn't take it all in. You know, you couldn't
yeah.
begin to respond that, because there was something like they had a guide through the concert halls. It was called. And there would be something like 6 events every night. And I drank in richly of that. Arthur Nikisch was the conductor of the Philharmonic when
mm-hmm.
I came there.
Mm-hmm.
And I never shall forget, as I stood outside of the concert bureau, which was very close to the Philharmonic Hall, and read the announcement of Busoni's concert, the content of his concert, which I have a program for you here.
Mm-hmm.
And reading both programs. He was announcing two concerts within the week. As I stood and read that, I saw two gentlemen coming arm in arm. You know who they were? Busoni and Nikish, walking up as I was standing, amazed, reading what his second program, which is not on that one, was the Hammer Clavier Sonata and the 24 Preludes of Chopin. That was all.
Yeah.
Nobody played programs like that at that time, you know.
No.
No. But I took in this I heard. I didn't hear because I had to go back to Denmark. I should, of course, have stayed and heard the second concert too. Mm. But somehow I had reservations, so I missed out on the second concert.
Yeah, Hermann Wolf was a...
Hermann Wolf was a great concert manager
director,
at that time. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I heard a funny story about Schnabel. I don't know if it's true, but it was attributed to him that he said, the thing that makes my programs different is that the second half is just as boring as the first half.
Yes, it's true. And it's just like it. He was terribly witty. Arthur Schnabel was a great preacher, just a great preacher. They had the saying in German, Zeit man den Schnabel hält, werden keine Witze erzählt. Since they hold their Schnabel is the mouth, you know?
Yeah.
So you hold your beak.
Yeah, beak.
Beak is the double meaning
Schnabel
of that.
The